Good morning, MABC. This is the day the Lord has made. Our God Almighty, our Savior and King, please stand with us as we celebrate His majesty.
Majesty, worship His majesty.
Rejoice and be glad in it, because Father, we know that you have a plan to prosper us and not to harm us, plan to give us a hope in the future. And so Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for each one that's here. I pray that when the message is preached, that your Spirit will move among us. I pray that as we continue to worship, that your Spirit will move among us, that we might walk out of here changed, more like your Son, that others might see Jesus in us. In His name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Welcome you to the 10:45 service. I'm glad you're here. If you're glad to hear, raise your hand if you're glad you're here. Looks like we got about 60%, Pastor, so it's up to you to get the other 40% into the house. Get excited, because that world out there hates us, okay? I just read in John. Were we reading in John somewhere?
I think so.
Yeah, that the world is going to hate us if we act like Jesus. So, but then the last part of that verse, he says, take heart, I've overcome the world.
That's right.
Did you read that? Anybody read that this week? Yeah. Thank you. There's one. I'm not going to ask for hands on that one. Okay. As you can tell, we have a lot of fun here at church. Church is not supposed to be a place where you just sit there and go, Is it time? Is it over? What's for lunch? Not that any of you think that. What I want you to think right now, if you're a visitor, on the side of the bulletin is a section that can be easily taken apart. And we ask that you just take a few minutes just to fill that out. Information that's requested. Offering plate will be passed a little later on during the service. You just fold it once, drop it in the offering plate. If you have a prayer request, that's for everybody here. Prayer request or a praise, you just write that there on the bottom. And if you don't mind, if you put your name on that also, we'll pray for that on Tuesday during staff meeting. We'll also pray during the week. So I've given you a couple of minutes to look around, see if you know everybody around you. If you know everybody, we're going to have a time to stand up and shake hands. If you don't know them, introduce yourself. You know, don't just go, I don't know you, I'm not going to talk to you, okay? But at this time also, when you stand to greet each other, I get to do children's sermon. It could be fun. Woohoo! All right, let's stand and greet each other. Job. All right. I noticed that you're sitting right here beside me. I don't pay her extra money, and so, but she's here right beside me. It also reminds me that every Sunday, most every Sunday, she does something special, and then she comes by the office, and I usually give her something special. So the deal is she takes notes on the pastor's sermon, and then she brings them to me, and then I give you a dollar. All right, so hey, I'm a youth guy. You know, I know what motivates. I know what motivates. Last week, Pastor was talking about, and y'all prayed for some people that headed off to do a mission trip, okay? And so I got here a globe. Has everybody ever seen a globe before? All right. You have one? Yeah, that's great. Okay, so anyway, they went. I almost said something I'd say in the youth group, but I wouldn't. So... where did they go? Does anybody know where? I'm going to spin it. And what's the chances of me hitting the space they're going to go without looking? You're right. They went to the Pacific Ocean. No, they didn't go there. Where did they go? Do you know where it's actually at on the map? What is the country?
Guatemala.
Very good. They're down there doing what we just sang about, spreading the glory of his name. Okay? To share with all. So now I'm going to see who knows where Guatemala is. We might have to go to the audience for this one. John, come here, sir, please. Come here. Come point out where Guatemala is to all these children. I haven't, I'm going to spin it so he might be confused. Oh. All right, John. Oh, man, that was good. And he speaks Spanish. Thank you, John. So right here, boys and girls, and we're almost done, in case you were wondering, is Guatemala, okay? So they went from right up here, Denver, all the way down to Guatemala. They flew into Dallas, Fort Worth, and then they flew down to a town in Guatemala, I hope, yes. So tell you what, God calls those three people. Do anybody remember the names? Oh, do you? Ooh, you should remember a couple of them. Okay, we'll start out here. Who
is it? Miss Mandy, Rose, and Michael.
Wow, give her a hand. Very good. All right. So I'll tell you what. Let's pray for them again while they're down there. And they're working with a organization, a ministry called Orphan Hearts. People that don't have mom and dads, they're working with those children, okay? They're ministering to them, okay? So let's pray for them again, okay? I'll get your question afterwards, okay? Heavenly Father, we just come to you right now. We thank you that you've led three of your people, Father, to go and work with children, malnutrition, that need love. Father, may they be able to show your love. May they be able to meet needs. And then, Father, may they return safe. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thanks, guys.
Well, you got to love it in church life whenever you start looking at each other like, aren't you next? No, you're next. I'm next. There we go. So it's good to know. Over the last few weeks, we've been reading in the books of John. And this week, we're going to read in John chapter 16. So we're spending 70 days in the books of John. We're reading a chapter a day, as Bill has already referenced. And this week, today, we're in John chapter 16. If you're not reading with us, that's no big deal, but you can start today. There's some bookmarks available. There's a red one that's just out through these doors. You can get it. It's just reading chapter a day. Monday through Thursday, you get Friday and Saturday to make up if you don't, if you've missed at some point in the week. And so you can just jump right on in with us as we read God's Word. John 16, we're going to start in the second half of verse 4. It's Jesus talking to us. It says, I did not say these things to you from the beginning because I was with you. But now, in verse 5, I'm going to him who sent me, and none of you asked me, where are you going? But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper, the Holy Spirit, will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment. Concerning sin, because they do not believe in me. Concerning righteousness, because I go to the Father and you will see me no longer. Concerning judgment, because the ruler of this world is judged. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all the truth. For he will not speak on his authority, his own authority. Whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. He will glorify me, for he will take what is mine and declare it to you. All that the Father has is mine. Therefore, I said that he will take what is mine and declare it to you. May God bless the reading of his word.
We pray for blessings, we pray for peace, comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering, and all the while you hear each spoken need, yet love us way too much to give us less things. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? We pray for wisdom, your voice to hear. We cry in anger when we cannot feel you're near. You doubt your goodness, we doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not enough. And all the while you hear his desperate plea, and long that we'd have faith to believe. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? When friends betray us, when darkness seems to win, we know that pain reminds this heart that this is not all. It's not our home. Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if my greatest disappointments or the aching of this life is the reveal of a greater thirst this world can't satisfy? What if trials of this life, the rain, the storms, the hardest nights, are your mercies in disguise?
Please stand with us. Please stand with us, and as we continue to worship the King.
Amen. Well, good morning, Mississippi Avenue. I mean, you can stay standing. You might be standing for a while, but you can stay standing if you want to. Somebody might say down in front. I don't know. Just tell you again just how much just love that you guys have expressed to my family and I just so greatly appreciate you. We are so very excited to be here. We're so excited to be here in Colorado. We're even excited that we can get ESPN and the SEC Network on Saturdays, and that makes our life whole and complete. So we praise God for that. But we do. We're excited. We're blessed to be here, and we want to thank you just for the love and affection you've expressed to us, to my family and I. We're doing well. Jonathan is playing soccer. Parker is doing karate, so you might want to watch out. If you ever think about rushing the stage, Parker will just miss you as he karate chops the air. It'll be good. But we're excited and blessed to be here in Aurora, excited to be a part of this church family. We just love it. Now, before we get started with the sermon, I do want to share a little bit of a vision for the church. Part of my history, as you may recall, is working in sort of the education and discipleship ministries of the church. So I'm really, really interested in looking at how do we make disciples. And for some of you, that might be an unfamiliar term. And for some of you, you've heard it for a million times over many years, and you have no idea what it means. Essentially, all we're going to say is discipleship is making us more like Jesus Christ. It's pretty easy definition. Now, in a church, there are at least, but we're going to boil it down to these three levels. There are three levels that discipleship occurs. There is, and we'll just go over these real quick, there's one on many, one on few, and there's one on one. Right? So I'm not proposing any sort of radical changes here. Now, can I get an amen? Has everybody sort of wiped the sweat off their brow? Yeah. So the one on many is what we're doing right now. This is a time of discipleship where we as many gather together before God and God changes us. So through worship, we worship through song, we worship through tithe, and we worship through word. God is making us more like His Son. As we participate in worship, God is transforming us. So we have one on many, what we're doing right now. Then we have one on few, and I'm going to skip over that for a second and come back to it. And then the third level is one on one. And that's the idea behind 70 days in the books of John, is that we, one on one with God, God is meeting with us as we read His Word. And so one on one is the sort of daily time that we spend in pursuing a relationship with God. So that is through God's Word. That's 70 days in the books of John. So we individually meet with God on a one-on-one basis, and as we do so, He makes us more like His Son. And I've said many times before, and I'm sure I'll say many times again, that I believe that the pastor of the church doesn't just tell you what to do. He doesn't just say, as you leave here, read God's Word more. I don't think that's enough. I think as we leave this place, it should be my job to equip you to that end. And that's why we've come up with a bookmark. So we say, read God's Word, and here's what we're going to do together. We're going to read God's Word together. And so we're reading a daily sort of Bible reading. We also have a devotional that goes along with it. And so we're not just telling you read God's Word. We're saying, here you go. I'm equipping you to do it. And then we're gently holding you accountable. Simply by saying, this week, we're in John 16. And then next Sunday we'll be in, if I can do math, John 21. And you can jump in at any point and any time, no worries. You'll get less of an experience if you jump in at Revelation 22, but if that's what you do, that would be great. So at any point, jump in with us. Now it's important for us to understand that in order for us to follow Christ, to become like Jesus Christ, we got to participate in all three levels. The one on many. I mean, we're told in God's Word, do not neglect the gathering of the body. So we have got to spend time as a church family, gather together, worshiping God in song, in word, and in tithe. That's how we become more like Christ. We also, every single day, whether it's in reading God's word or in prayer or what have you, any number of other spiritual disciplines, we become more like Christ in a one-on-one level. And then I skipped that middle one. One on few. Now, one on few is the Sunday school ministry of this church. This is an at least weekly gathering with a small group of people, typically that are of your life age, or your same age, or your life stage. So it might be somebody who is the same age as you, or it simply might be somebody of the same life stage as you. At Cross Church, we had somebody who was in our Sunday school class who was 55 years old. No big deal. Why in the world would he be in my Sunday school class? Well, it's because he had a second grader. God bless the man, right? God bless the man. He had a kid at 50. Better him than me. But he was same life stage. He had elementary age kids. So he became a part of our Sunday school class. So this group, this idea is that this group is also just as crucial in helping each of us, each and every single Christian, to grow in Christ's likeness. And the idea is also is that this group will help you in times of need. They will encourage you when you're at your lowest, and they will celebrate you with you when you're at your best. So if you're not a part of a Sunday school class, I really want to encourage you with just about the strongest words that I can to be a part of one. Now, you might join this church for any number of reasons, or you might attend for any number of reasons. You like the worship. You like the location. You like the color of the pews. People join for any number of reasons. But you stay, most people stay, because of the relationships that they build. So it might be any number of things that bring you to the church, but you stay because of the friendships that you develop. And to this end, what I want to do is encourage you, if you're not a part of it, to become a part of it, to become a part of a Sunday school class. This group is to be your friends at church. And you will stick around this church whenever you make friends in this church. Now, to this end, because each of these areas are important, the one on many, the one on few, and the one on one, but because the one on few ministry is so important, it is a place that you make relationships, you build friendships. You probably shouldn't be building a friendship right now with your neighbor. I mean, I would ask you not to. But just wait a few minutes until I'm done. But for you to build relationships, we have to have a strong one-on-few ministry of this church, a Sunday school ministry of this church. And since I arrived in late July, I have been responsible for this ministry. And this is because, sadly, the person who was responsible left in May. So I need someone who is responsible for it. It's absolutely a crucial part of the ministry of this church. I need someone who can help the leaders of our church, our Sunday school leaders, encourage the building of relationships to the study of God's word and the gathering of small groups into Sunday school. And just in case you don't receive the weekly sort of e-newsletter, if you don't, you've got a piece of paper that you can tear out of your worship guide. You can write your email address on it and say, "Mark, sign me up for that." So if you don't receive it, or if you don't read it, the personnel committee and I, we have been meeting and will be ready, Lord willing, to present a candidate who will be responsible for this area of the church. He will be responsible for the education and the administration ministries of this church. And because I prefer the short and simple. You can just blame me being an Aggie. It's got to be short and simple. I prefer the short and simple to the long and complicated. Rather than call this person the education and administration pastor, we're simply giving him the title of executive pastor. So I'm going to ask you, I'm going to pray, and I'm going to ask for you to pray for this person. We're in the final steps to being able to present him to you and his family. So I'm going to ask for you, even just right now as I pray, if you'll pray along with me for them. So let's pray. Father, we thank you for your church. We thank you that we can gather together as a group of your people and that we can become more like your Son. And I pray, Father, for anybody, if this is all that they do, Lord, I pray that you will just speak into them. As we read about the Holy Spirit, our helper, who speaks into your people, I pray that you'll speak into them and encourage them to be a part of both a Sunday school class and to pursue you in a one-on-one basis every day this week. And Father, I just pray, Lord, that you will rise up this person. We have somebody in mind. We just ask for you to bless and anoint. If he's the person that you have for us, we just ask for you to make the pathway straight. So Lord, we put all these things in your hand, asking for you to bless and anoint this church. And I thank you so much for this church. It is so exciting to see your hand on this church and your Spirit on the move in this church, that we ask for you to bless and anoint. And then, Lord, as I speak from your word today, we ask for you to, again, just put your Spirit at work, speaking into each of our lives today. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. So turn in your Bibles or open your apps to John chapter 8. We're going to start in verse 48. Yeah, there's Bibles in the pew in front of you. If you didn't bring one, that's all good. That's why we got them. And if you don't own one, you can take that one. Nobody will stop you at the door. Unless you have like 10 and you're putting them on eBay or something. We might have a problem. Now in today's passage, in John chapter 8, 48, starting in 48, Jesus is going to make, in this passage, an incredible claim. It's all about himself, and it's going to be almost one that is too hard to believe. In fact, for many people of his day, they just couldn't believe it, which made me think about some other outrageous claims. The history of advertising are filled with products that make just some outrageous claims. Now, are you familiar with Nivea cream? Do you use Nivea cream? Have you ever used it? I don't. I use Kroger brand or King Supers brand or whatever. Now, in 2009, Nivea, which is not a small company, came out with a cream that they claimed would make you skinny. They did. It was called My Silhouette Slimming Cream. I promise you that it does not work. Otherwise, our staff room would be stocked, and your pastors would be just using it all day, every day, but it just does not work. And otherwise, we would just all give glory and honor to Nivea cream. Now, Nivea got into a lot of trouble. They had to pay a hefty fine, because this just was a blatant lie. It was just simply not true. Now, the same thing is true if you remember of acai berries. Do you remember acai berries? A few years ago, the acai berry craze, and they made the exact same claim that it was just pure magic. It only worked at Hogwarts, but if you ate acai berries, they would also make you skinny. This is how we know that this isn't true, because we have other berries at the store. Right? If this was true, if acai berries could make you skinny, we would sit around the table one day and say, do you remember strawberries? Do you remember raspberries? And you just sit there and say, yeah, kind of. But all we eat are acai berries because acai berries make you skinny. This is just patently not true. Then again, some outrageous claims are true. In the 32 World Series. I have in my notes 1993, and that just can't be true. That Babe Ruth, while at bat, predicted he would hit a home run. You've heard this story, right? Babe Ruth is at bat, and he's even jawing with the other team. And he finally calls to the pitcher and says, I'm going to hit a home run right over that wall. And what does Babe Ruth do? He backs it up. He backs up his claim. He knocks that ball out of the park. Bill was there. He can tell you about it. Bill, I promise next week I won't do that. And then I'll apologize after I do. And even a few years ago, before the 2011 NBA season, so the 2010-2011 NBA season, a shooting guard named Jason Terry, he played for the Dallas Mavericks. And right before the season started, this was just This was just crazy. They didn't stop talking about it in Dallas. He got a tattoo. And his tattoo was of the championship trophy. And he wrote down that season. This is before the season. And if you've ever been a Mavericks fan in your life, you know that there's no chance, no way, no how they'd ever win a thing. But it came true. And Jesus also, he makes an amazing claim, and it's also one that is absolutely true, and we're going to read about it here in John chapter 8, verses 48 through 59. You'll read along with me. And it says, the Jews asked him, are we not right in saying that you are a Samaritan and have a demon? And Jesus answered, I don't have a demon, but I honor my Father and you dishonor me. Yet I do not seek my own glory. There is one who seeks it and he is the judge. Truly, truly, I say to you, if anyone keeps my word, he will not see death. The Jews said to him, now we know that you have a demon. Abraham died, as did the prophets, yet you say, if anyone keeps my word, he will never taste death. Are you greater than our father Abraham, who died, and the prophets died? Who do you make yourself out to be? And Jesus answered, if I glorify myself, my glory is nothing. It is my Father who glorifies me, of whom you say, he is our God. But you have not known him. I know him. If I were to say that I do not know him, I would be a liar like you. But I do know him, and I keep his word. Your father Abraham rejoiced that he would see my day. He saw it and was glad. So the Jews answered him, you are not yet even 50 years old, and have you seen Abraham? Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. So they picked up stones to throw it at him. But Jesus hid himself and went out from the temple. In today's passage, it's almost like we're dropped right in the middle of an argument, right in the middle of a heavyweight fight. Jesus and a contingent of disagreeable Jews are having an argument. And over again, in the verses that precede today's passage, this group is arguing with Jesus over who he is. They believe that his teachings and his miracles are not from God. Now Jesus, again, he responds over and over again that if they claim to have God as their father, and yet they don't listen to the message that God gave to him, then they must not be true followers of God. I mean, anyone who claims to follow God must listen to Jesus' words. But these Jews refuse, this certain group of Jews refuse to listen. And so the argument, the squabble continues. In fact, the argument is so heated that in verse 48, it gets out of hand. The Jews use the equivalent of a racial slur against Jesus. In fact, this slur, that Jesus is a Samaritan, a group of people that are hated by the Jews, is even worse. It's even an innuendo that says, no one knows who your real dad is. And so it must be a Samaritan. To make the insult even more clear, they say that Jesus has a demon. This is vicious, vicious opposition to Christ. Now, this is the amazing thing about Jesus, that whatever evil or ugliness that we may face in life, he's faced it too. Those who have been in this room, those who have been on the receiving end of a racial slur, I just want you to take heart. Jesus has too. That everything that we face in life, whatever evil or ugliness that we face in life, Jesus has faced it too. He then rejects. Jesus just rejects what they say about him. And he says, if you dishonor me, you are dishonoring God. In other words, if you dishonor me instead of glorifying me, you set yourself against God. If you oppose me, if you oppose Jesus, you oppose the one who has sent him. If you ignore the messenger, if you reject the messenger, you're rejecting the sender. That's what Jesus is saying. If you discard me, then you reject God. And you will face the consequences. In verse 50, Jesus warns them of impending judgment. And what is needed is to heed the warning. Now, there are many times in my life, as you can imagine, that I didn't heed a warning. And in thinking about this week, one event stood out in my mind. And I was in, junior high. I don't think I was quite in high school. And my mom and I, we went to lunch. And so we decide upon this Chinese restaurant. So we go to this Chinese restaurant, and they give us, what is it? Those two sort of jars, right? One is sweet and sour sauce, and the other is hot mustard, yeah? So I think this meal would taste better with a mountain of hot mustard on it. And my mom warned me, and I didn't listen. So I make a hot mustard soup, and I got through one bite of the food and didn't eat anything else probably the rest of that day. I was in absolute misery. Have you ever been there? Where your sinuses are on fire, your nose is running without end, and you want to die. I was there. My mom warned me, and I didn't listen. It wasn't the last time that she warned me and I didn't listen, and I'm sure it won't be the last time that I won't listen either. And unfortunately, those criticizing Jesus, they too wouldn't listen to him. He's giving them ample warning. And yet, his warning fell on unlistening ears. Now, in warning the critics around him, Jesus then follows it up with another statement. And he says, what you think about me doesn't matter. What you think about me is immaterial. God's approval is everything, because he is the judge. Now, the comforting thing for those of us, for those of us that are gathered here that are Christians, is that we, in some respects and in some ways, we hold to unpopular opinions. We hold to, as long as we are standing on God's Word and we're speaking of God's Word and we are pointing back to God's Word, we hold some unpopular opinions. And there are going to be some people who come and who criticize us, who call us ugly things and who use ugly words and claim ugly things against us. And in fact, we're getting to a point where our position, which is the biblical position, the godly position, is going to be seen as the evil position. And people are going to claim that we, God's people, are evil. But here's the truth that Jesus gives to us today. Their opinion doesn't matter. Now, we don't want to be mean about it. We don't want to be ugly about it. We are still called to love God and to love others, even when we hold unpopular opinions. So we do it in no mean-spirited way. We do it in kindness and in godliness, in a loving way, and yet we still stand on and through and with God's Word. And if we do so in a kind and loving way, God will glorify us. God will honor us. And we don't have to worry one single bit about what others think of us. If they claim that we are evil, and yet we know that we are good, it doesn't matter. If they claim that we are wrong and mean, it doesn't matter. I mean, they point to Jesus and they say that Jesus of all people has a demon. So we as Jesus followers, what should we expect? That we too at some point and in some places are going to be told that we must have a demon. And yet if we stand on God's Word and we speak through God's Spirit and we do so in a loving and kind way, does their opinion matter? Does their opinion matter, God's people? No. There's only one. There's only one opinion that matters, and it's God's opinion. Now Jesus continues. He continues to be unconcerned with what the critics think. And in verse 51, he says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, if anyone keeps my word, he will never see death." In saying truly twice or verily twice, Jesus, all he is saying is he's saying to us, listen up. And after getting their attention, Jesus explains, if someone keeps his word, in other words, If someone believes it, someone cleaves to it, someone obeys it, someone lives by it, he or she will never see death. Jesus wanted his critics, and what he wants of us today is he wants everyone to receive the promise. To receive the promise of eternal life. Now this promise, if you're new to this place or you're new to the faith, it may seem really hard to believe, to never taste death. And after all, Jesus' disciples, we can say they believed his word. They obeyed his word. They cleaved to his word. They taught his word. They loved his word. And yet they died. But what Jesus wants us to receive is the deeper promise that those who believe and those who obey will not experience eternal death. And in a few minutes, I'm going to call on all those who have never believed in Jesus Christ. There are going to be people in this room who have never believed, consciously believed in Jesus Christ and committed to keep his word. I'm going to call upon you today to do so. Now there is, in all likelihood, there's people who are gathered in this place all throughout this room who think, I have always been a Christian. I've been one since birth. And I'm here to say, I'm sorry, that's not what God's word tells us. There was a time when I was not a Christian. And if you want a testimony, you can talk to my parents. They will be happy to. My kindergarten teacher, my first grade teacher, they're not here today, but they give you the same testimony. That there was a time when I was not a Christian. And I had to, at some point in my life, decide. I am going to believe these things about Jesus. That he died for my sin, that he was raised to life, and then I had to commit to follow him. It's not perfect. I've not been perfect. But I've known ever since that day that I will not taste eternal death. That's possible for you too. You can't assume your way into heaven. You can't just think, I've been a Christian my whole life. It requires a commitment, and then even God's word tells us, it requires almost daily commitment. A decision, I will live this day for Jesus Christ. I have been crucified with Christ. Therefore, I no longer live, but he lives in me. There is no one, no one person who's ever lived who's just assumed their way into heaven. There has been a lot of people who have assumed, and when they die, they'll be separated tragically. Separated for all of eternity. Now these same critics of Jesus, they assumed that when they died, they would go to heaven. They had the same exact assumption as some of us do here today. But you must consciously, actively believe in Jesus Christ. You must obey his word, follow him for your life, and you will be saved. And so we're here today just to simply say, receive the promise he offers. It's a free gift that he offers to each and every one of us today. So don't be like the critics who refuse to believe. Now in verses 53 to 59, we see what his critics sort of think of Jesus. In 52, they say to him, now we know that you have a demon, because even Abraham and the prophets, they die. His must have a demon because his claim is just too incredible to believe. For it to be true, they think, Jesus must be greater than Abraham. That Jesus must be greater than Moses. He must be greater than Elijah and Elisha and Isaiah and Jeremiah. And if I knew the rest of the books of the Bible, I'd say those names too. I just would get embarrassed if I forgot someone. And I might make up some. In fact, what the amazing thing is that Jesus is greater. He is greater than their heroes. He is greater than Abraham. He is greater than Moses. He is greater than Elijah and Elisha and Isaiah and Jeremiah and Ezekiel and all the rest. He is greater. I mean, that thought just never crossed their mind. What if it's true? What if this person in front of us, offering to us eternal life, is the greatest human being that ever lived. It just never even crossed their mind that it could possibly be true. But he is greater. He is greater. And in fact, in response to their ridicule, because at this point they're just making fun of him, Jesus makes this claim. And he says, before Abraham was, I am. You can tell from his critics' response that they knew exactly what he was saying. They knew the severity of what Jesus said because they proceeded to pick up rocks. They proceeded to pick up stones to throw them at him to kill him. For us, it may be a little bit harder to understand. But what we must do is understand the implication of Jesus' statement. Now, Jesus, in a sense, he's using bad grammar. But it's a good thing there were no English teachers around. In fact, if he just wanted to claim that he was older than Abraham, he could have said, before Abraham was born, I was born. But that's not what Jesus says. He says, before Abraham was, I am. Now in Exodus 3, the second book of the Bible, a simple shepherd named Moses is out caring for his flocks. And he notices something odd, that a bush is burning, but it is never extinguished. That a bush starts to burn, and it never completely is consumed. Not seeing that every day, Moses decides to go and check it out. And Moses approaches this burning bush, and the burning bush starts to talk. And it's God's voice who speaks out of those flames, and he tells Moses to return to Egypt and to let all the other Israelites out of slavery. Now Moses, not entirely sure of himself, he says to the bush, well, when I go, who should I say sent me? And God responds with, I am. You tell those people that I am is sending you. In English, that's three letters. In Hebrew, it's four. In Greek, it's actually seven, because they make things hard. But Jesus knows exactly what he is saying when he tells his critics that he is the I am. He knows exactly what he says. He's absolutely emphatic about who he is. He is the great I am. And the implication of that is that he is God. But what does it mean for us? This is all well and good, but what does it mean for us that Jesus is the great I am? What it means for us as we go about our daily life, it means that he knows, Jesus knows, and Jesus cares. The great I am knows and he cares. Jesus, as God, knows of your pain. He knows of your problems. He knows of your afflictions. And he cares. The great I am knows and cares. So if you have a broken relationship, Jesus knows and Jesus cares. If you or someone you love is sick, Jesus knows and Jesus cares. If you know somebody you love that is going through cancer, this is the amazing thing about Jesus Christ. Jesus knows and Jesus cares. Whatever your problem is, whatever you are facing, he knows and he cares. If your home life is impossible, Jesus knows and Jesus cares. If you have a bad job, Jesus knows and Jesus cares. If you're unemployed, he knows and he cares. If you're underemployed, he knows and he cares. If school feels impossible right now, Like, you'll never get trigonometry, and nobody gets trigonometry. It's okay. Jesus knows, and Jesus cares. Whatever we face in life, He knows and He cares. If you are grieving, if you've lost somebody that you love, Jesus knows and Jesus cares. No matter how big, no matter how small, no matter how significant or insignificant, Jesus knows and Jesus cares. And all He's doing is He is waiting for you. He is waiting for you. 1 Peter tells us, if we cast all our cares on Him, He will care for us. That's all we have to do. Cast all your cares on Him, and He will care for you. If there is some sin, if you are stuck in sin, and you just think, Jesus, I can never get over this, guess what? Jesus knows, and He cares, and He will do something about it if you just hand it over to Him. In Hebrews 4, we are told, since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. We don't have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet is without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace in our time of need. So no matter what you are facing, no matter what you are facing, if you have a deep desire of your heart, He knows before you even voice it. He knows and He cares. And He wants you. He wants you to simply draw near to Him. He wants you to come near to Him and say, God, this might seem small to you, but it's a big deal to me. And Jesus says, I know and I care. When we follow Jesus, the Son of God, the great I Am, He knows our afflictions and our problems, so we give all of them to Him, and we can be confident that He will care for us. We give them to Jesus because we know that He knows and He cares and He will care for us no matter what we face. Let's pray. Jesus, we thank You. We thank You that You are the great I Am, that You know and You care. And because You know and You care, that You will care for us. That all we need to do is bring our afflictions, bring our pain, bring our grief, bring our problems to You, and that You know them and You will care for us. And so I pray, Father, if there is any burden that we are bearing, that we are carrying today, that we are bearing, Lord, I pray that each and every single one of us, Lord, whatever that burden is, whatever that problem is, that we will cast them at Your feet, confident that You know us, You love us, You will care for us. And Holy Spirit, I ask, if there's anyone in this room that doesn't know You as Lord and Savior, who is always assumed, that You'll speak into them at this time, and they will come to faith in You. It's in Your name we pray. In verse 59, Jesus' enemies, they pick up stones in order to kill Him. But the Bible tells us that Jesus slips away. His time had not yet come. Those critics were not in charge of Jesus' life or Jesus' death. They weren't in charge here in this passage, and they certainly were not in charge chapters later, years later, when Jesus is standing before them and going to the cross. They weren't in charge. They thought they were. They thought they were condemning Jesus to the cross. But Jesus went to the cross of His own volition, of His own desire, His own willingness. If it was not His time, He would not have gone. He could have stood in front of Pontius Pilate and said, guess what, buddy? Not my time yet. I'm going home. Jesus was in charge over His life and His death. And the amazing thing is that he chose when and where to die. And he did it for you and for me. He is worth our everything. The only person who can choose when and where he died is the one who is worth committing our entire life to. And if you have yet to commit that life to him, the life that he died for, you can do so today. Rick, Bill, and I, we will be down front ready to share with you exactly what it takes to commit your life to Jesus Christ. Now, there might be some here today who think, you know what, I'm just not quite sure that I believe that Jesus knows and Jesus cares about my pain. So as we stand down front, as Pam leads in song, we would be overjoyed to pray with that for you, to pray over that pain, to pray over that problem, to pray over your grief, and pray to the one who tells us to cast all our cares on him. We're also, if you are in search of a church family and God is leading you here, you will not find one better. So Bill, Rick, and I, we will be down front, ready, excited, eager to share with you about becoming a part of this church family. Pam.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide. Where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in awe of you. I'm in awe of you. Where your love ran red and my sins washed white, I owe all to you. I owe all to you. There's a place where sin and shame are powerless, where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness, where all the love I've ever like a flood comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in awe of you. I'm in awe of you. Where your love ran red and my sins washed white, I owe all to you, I owe all to you, Jesus.
Please join me in prayer. Father, we do all owe all to you. If it weren't for you, we wouldn't even be here. But more importantly, we owe our lives and whatever that constitutes. Father, help us to honor you by our time, treasure, and talent. And in this moment, the treasure is how we continue to honor you and worship you. Father, I ask that you bless that treasure to the continuing discipleship of your body, that we can go out and do your word. And as Peter intimates in the lesson that we learned today, that allows us to call out to others out of the darkness and into your light. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Now, Bill and I, we're going to remain down front after the end of the service. And if you're not familiar with or you're not comfortable with walking down the aisle during the invitation, Bill and I will just stand here on the wings and we'll be ready to visit with you if you have questions about anything that you've seen here today or anything you've heard here today. Or if you're still in need of prayer or you want to join the church, we'll be here for you. And this means that if you don't have those concerns, if you could just wait a few minutes while Bill and I just wait on those whom the Lord might still be working in. Yesterday, we had a great Beth Moore simulcast with our women's ministry. Heard great things. I'm just grateful that you came to hear this guy after you heard her yesterday. That's amazing. It's an honor. So I want to thank to all those involved in our women's ministry for putting it together. I heard it went marvelously. Now, this Saturday, September 24th, we have our first men's breakfast of the fall. It will be from 8 a.m. to 9:30 in the gym. Of course, for some of you, you want to show up at 7:30, and I'm sure they will let you in. So bring a friend, bring $5, and it's going to be a great morning. And the last announcement is simply that next Sunday afternoon at 5 p.m. in the conference room, we will have a meeting for those who are interested in going on a trip to the Holy Land. The trip is next March. The trip and the information meeting will be led by Carl Ryder. And Carl is a former pastor here at MABC. He's not coming in view of a call. I do want to point out that I'm wearing the same jacket that mysteriously had a button fly off, and it fits just fine. It fits just fine. So we're excited to have everybody here today, and we're excited to be a part of this church family, and I'm going to invite Foster, if you will, close us out in song.
Just one more very quick announcement. The bulletin says there's handbell practice tonight. There isn't. It's been canceled. Michelle? Please stand with us.
Jesus Messiah, name above all. Blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all.
Amen. Hallelujah. Everybody have a great week. God bless you.